Please stand. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you.
And also with you.
God invites us to come into his presence and worship him with humble and penitent hearts. Therefore, let us acknowledge our sinfulness and ask him to forgive us. Holy and merciful Father, I confess that I am by nature sinful and that I have disobeyed you in my thoughts, words, and actions. I have done what is evil and failed to do what is good. For this I deserve your punishment, both now and in eternity. But I am truly sorry for my sins, and trusting in my Savior, Jesus Christ, I pray, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner. God, our Heavenly Father, has been merciful to us and has given his only Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Therefore, as a called servant of Christ and by his authority, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
For all that we need in life and for the wisdom to use all your gifts with gratitude and joy, hear our prayer, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the steadfast assurance that nothing can separate us from your love, and for the courage to stand firm against the assaults of Satan and every evil, hear our prayer, O Christ.
Christ, have mercy.
For the well-being of your holy Church in all the world, and for those who offer here their worship and praise, hear our prayer, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Merciful God, maker and preserver of life, uphold us by your power and keep us in your tender care. The works of the Lord are great and glorious. His name is worthy of praise.
O Lord, our Lord, how glorious is your name in all the earth. Almighty God, merciful Father, you crown our life with your love. You take away our sin. You comfort our spirit. Us pure and holy in your sight. You did not spare your only Son, but gave him up for us all. O Lord, our Lord, how glorious is your name in all the earth. O Son of God, eternal Word of the washed us from our sins in your own blood. You are the King of glory. You are the Lord. O Lord, our Lord, how glorious is your name in all the earth.
Let us pray. O God, in the glorious transfiguration of your only begotten Son, you confirmed the mysteries of the faith by the testimony of Moses and Elijah. And in the voice that came from the bright cloud, you foreshadowed our adoption as your sons. In your mercy, make us co-heirs of the glory with Jesus our King, and bring us at last to heaven. through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated. We give our attention on this Transfiguration Sunday to the Word of God, recorded for us, first of all, in the book of Exodus, chapter 24, reading verses 9 to 18. This section from Exodus is often read on Transfiguration Sunday because it's another time that the Lord let some people of this earth see his glory. In an unusual situation where Moses and 70 elders and a couple others were able to actually see God, and yet they lived. We hear from Exodus chapter 24. Moses and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and the 70 elders of Israel went up and saw the God of Israel. Under his feet was something like a pavement made of lapis lazuli, as bright blue as the sky. But God did not raise his hand against these leaders of the Israelites. They saw God, and they ate and drank. The Lord said to Moses, "Come up to me on the mountain and stay here, and I will give you the tablets of stone with the law and commandments I have written for their instruction." Then Moses set out with Joshua, his aide, and Moses went up on the mountain of God. He said to the elders, "Wait here for us until we come back to you. Aaron and Hur are with you, and anyone involved in a dispute can go to them." When Moses went up on the mountain, the cloud covered it, and the glory of the Lord settled on Mount Sinai. For 6 days, the cloud covered the mountain, and on the seventh day, the Lord called to Moses from within the cloud. To the Israelites, the glory of the Lord looked like a consuming fire on top of the mountain. Then Moses entered the cloud as he went up on the mountain, and he stayed on the mountain 40 days and 40 nights. The word of the Lord. We'll join together in singing our psalm for today, Psalm 2D. It's printed in your worship folder. We'll sing the entire psalm in unison.
Proclaim the Lord's decree. He said,
Son, today I have become your Father. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Great are the works of the Lord. Alleluia, alleluia. Great are the works of the Lord. Our second lesson is recorded for us in the second letter that Peter wrote, chapter 1, verses 16 to 21. These will also be the words that we will meditate on from God's word a little bit later in our service today. Peter writes, "For we did not follow cleverly devised stories when we told you about the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ in power, but we were eyewitnesses of the majesty. He received honor and glory from God the Father when the voice came to him from the majestic glory, saying, 'This is my Son, whom I love, with him I am well pleased.' We ourselves heard this voice that came from heaven when we were with him on the sacred mountain. We also have the prophetic message as something completely reliable, and you will do well to pay attention to it as to a light shining in a dark place until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts. Above all, you must understand that no prophecy of Scripture came about by the prophet's own interpretation of things. For prophecy never had its origin in the human will, but prophets, though human, spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our verse of the day, Alleluia. A cloud covered them, and a voice came from the cloud. "This is my Son, whom I love. Listen to him." Alleluia. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. These words are written that we may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son. Stand for the reading of the Gospel of our Lord Jesus. The Holy Gospel for today is recorded in the 17th chapter of the Gospel according to St. Matthew, beginning with the first verse. This is the account that Peter was referring to in the lesson we had from Peter just a few moments ago. After 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter, James, and John, the brother of James, and led them up a high mountain by themselves. There he was transfigured before them. His face shone like the sun, and his clothes became as white as the light. Just then there appeared before them Moses and Elijah talking with Jesus. Peter said to Jesus, "Lord, it is good for us to be here. If you wish, I will put up 3 shelters, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." While he was still speaking, a bright cloud covered them, and a voice from the cloud said, "This is my Son, whom I love. With him I am well pleased. Listen to him." When the disciples heard this, they fell face down to the ground, terrified. But Jesus came and touched them. "Get up," he said. "Don't be afraid." When they looked up, they saw no one except Jesus. As they were coming down the mountain, Jesus instructed them, "Don't tell anyone what you have seen until the Son of Man has been raised from the dead." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to you.
Please be seated. We continue with our hymn of the day, number 388, Down from the Mount of Glory. Be with you all. The word of God that we're going to meditate on this morning, as I mentioned, are the words from Peter as he described what happened on the Mount of Transfiguration we just read about a few moments ago. We will not reread that at this time. Let us bow our heads in a prayer. O Lord, sanctify us by the truth. Your word is truth. Amen. Dear friends in Christ, was the Little Mermaid ever a real person? Is Peter Pan real? Did Alice really fall down a rabbit's hole and end up in Wonderland? I think you recognize it. Those are all fairy tales. Fairy tales that have been turned into animated movies, and I'm willing to guess that most, if not all of us, have seen one or other of those movies at some time. A fairy tale is not real. The characters don't exist. The magical things that they do never happened. We might put into that category the Transformers, the Avengers, Superman, Ant-Man, and all the others. They aren't real. The powerful things that they did can't be done. They're just made-up stories about made-up characters with made-up abilities. But you know, there's a little bit of a danger in all of the fairy tales that we have been brought up with. Now, don't get me wrong. It's not wrong to watch those fairy tales and enjoy those movies. But we have to be careful that we don't read the Bible that way. Some do. Some say that creation is just a myth. It never really happened. Those were made up people. Some say that the account of the flood is just a legend that's been handed down through the ages. And some say that Jesus was just a man. A man who really wasn't born of the Virgin Mary. A man who never did any of those mighty miracles that we see and didn't live the life that we think. Well, today, the Apostle Peter insists to us that who Jesus is and what Jesus did is 100% real and true. And starting with this very fact, that Jesus is truly and really the Son of God, they were witnesses. Now let's just back up to something else for a second, because it is true and it is real that there was a place called the Garden of Eden. And there were real people in that garden even who had the name Adam and Eve. They were created as people. They looked like people. But though they were people, and only people, created by God through the seduction of Satan, they aspired to be equal to God. And by doing that, they brought death and destruction into our world. You know, that aspiration to be God spooks around in our hearts a little bit too yet, doesn't it? It shows up sometimes when we ask the question, why, God? Why did you let this happen to me? It surfaces sometimes in the anger we feel when God doesn't answer our prayer the way we want him to answer our prayer. It exhibits itself once in a while when we doubt God's goodness, that God really isn't looking out for our best or maybe the best of a loved one that we have in our lives. We're then aspiring to be God, aren't we? We're questioning God, suggesting that we know better than God, that we would love differently than God would. We would act differently than God because we have a better idea of how to do things. That aspiration to be equal to God in our hearts is sin. It's sinful pride. It's sinful arrogance. It's sinful ego. But here's the most amazing thing of all. God sent his Son into this world to be a human being, but not just a human being. The scripture tells us that he was in the form of God, yet he made himself nothing. And that's what Peter and James and John witnessed on that mountaintop. They witnessed the truth of that statement. They saw Jesus in the form of God. They saw him as the God-man in all of the glory which he always had. But even though he was God and existed as God and therefore was in the form of God, Jesus didn't put his deity on display before the eyes of people. He didn't make full use of his divine glory and power as he walked this earth. He looked like a mere man. He humbled himself as a human being. In fact, he allowed himself to be treated as the lowest of human beings of all, even to the point of going to that disgraceful cross. But Jesus did that in order that he might be our substitute and be our Savior. Jesus was true and very God, and yet he took on the form of man and became a man willingly in order that you and I one day might share his glory. And that is what Peter and James and John witnessed. They witnessed that Jesus was the majestic Son of God who came to this world as a true man to die for us. And so when Peter and James and John and all the other disciples talk about the power which Jesus had, and they describe to us all the other things that Jesus did, and his death, and his resurrection, and the fact that he's coming again one day to this earth to take us to be with him, those things are all real. They are all true. They are things that these men witnessed, just as surely as they witnessed Jesus in his glory on top of that mountain. They aren't made up fairy tales. They aren't things developed by Disney and Marvel. They aren't legends that have been passed down and embellished from age to age. These are the eyewitness accounts of those who were there and saw Jesus' glory. And they weren't just eyewitnesses. They were also ear witnesses. For Peter tells us they heard God in that amazing cloud that covered that mountain speak. And he said, "This is my Son, the one I love, and with him I am well pleased." Most people didn't see Jesus like that. But Jesus showed himself to these witnesses so that they could later tell us, this isn't a fairy tale. Jesus is really God. And he really did what God wanted him to do. He really died and redeemed us from our sins. And that brings us to a second truth of this lesson today. And that is that the Bible, the scriptures, are the true word of God. The Bible is not a fairy tale book in what it tells us. The Bible is filled with prophecy. And prophecy is simply the message from God to people. A message that sometimes even tells the future. And Peter tells us that all of these prophecies were now fulfilled in Jesus Christ, or were going to be fulfilled in him. And so God's word is reliable because everything that God said in his word was fulfilled. Everything happened just as God said it would. Even those things that are so fantastic that our human brains can't even wrap themselves around them. They're real and they happened. Why is God's word reliable? Because it's not people's words. It's God's words. And that's what we call the teaching or the doctrine of verbal inspiration. That means that every word that's in the Bible was inspired by God. Now, when I say inspired there, I'm not talking about when an artist goes out and sees a wonderful sunset and then comes back and paints a picture of that wonderful sunset because he was so moved by that sunset. Scripture uses the word inspire in the sense of to be breathed in. And the idea is that the Holy Spirit was breathed into the men who wrote the Bible. People like David and Moses and Jeremiah and Isaiah and all the others in the Old Testament, as well as Peter and Paul and Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, they were given the power to write what they did by the Holy Spirit, so that they didn't write what they came up with in their own minds and thoughts. They didn't write what they wanted to. They wrote what was the will of God. Peter tells us today in our text that they were carried along. They were moved by the Holy Spirit. And so they wrote the word of God. And so this word in the Bible is not people's words. It is the word of God, and therefore it is truth. A truth that we need so desperately in this world of lies and fairy tales that we live in. So Peter says, pay attention to it as to a lamp that's shining in a dark place. You talk about a dark place. Listen to some of the thinking that comes out of our world. Oh, just let children do what they want. Just Let them go their own way, and they'll eventually do what's right. Don't tell people that they did wrong. Don't discipline children, because you're going to give them a bad feeling about themselves, and they won't have a good self-image then. Just do your best, and God will accept it, because God is love. There is no judgment day. There is no hell. Everybody's going to end up in a better place. What darkness from the minds of human beings. But the truth, the reality, is found in God's word. And that reality is a light in this darkness that we are to pay attention to. And that reality is this: humble yourself before God, repent, and he forgives our sins because of what Jesus did for us, and we are saved. We love one another because God first loved us. And the Creator who made you and me is the very one who came to this world and died on the cross for us so that we could be saved. That's God's truth. And that truth makes a difference in our world. It gives hope to miserable sinners like us. It is the message that there is a perfect place where we will be perfect in glory with our God forever when we humble ourselves before God and believe his truth. There is a refuge for us in this dark world, a refuge where love shines, a love for all people, no matter what we've done. That's the truth. In the words that just follow our text today, Peter says, "But false prophets also arose among the people, just as there will also be false teachers among you." False teachers are teaching fairy tales. What they teach does not come from God. It comes from their own minds, their deceptive myths, their destructive heresies. But Peter is telling us today what's true, not a fairy tale, because this is the truth about the Son of God, Jesus Christ, a truth which they witnessed. They were eyewitnesses of his glory, and they are now telling us. And so Peter says, listen to him. Listen to this word. And test everything that you hear on the basis of this truth. Most of you have probably gotten up at some time in your life before dawn, and maybe you've looked towards where the sun is going to rise, and you've seen a bright light in that east. And that we often call the morning star, but it's not a star at all. It's Venus, and it's reflecting the light of the sun. But it's there as kind of a precursor most of the time of the glorious light which is about to break into the world as a glorious new day. Well, Peter says Jesus is our morning star in a spiritual sense. Because when Jesus, the Son of God, came to this world and humbled himself to die on the cross for our sins and paid for our sins, that's the gospel light that saves us. And that's the gospel light that has already broken into our world and is shining for us. But it's a precursor. It's a foreshadowing of the glorious place that we will be and the glorious light of our salvation that will soon be ours. And so Peter tells us, pay attention. Pay attention to that morning star. Pay attention and believe. Because one day, that glory that they saw on the mountaintop will be ours. This is no fairy tale. Amen. Please stand. We join now in confessing our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed today, as printed in your worship folder. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became fully human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who in unity with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. In great joy of the transfiguration of our Savior and what it tells us about Jesus and what he did for us, we bring our offerings of thanks to our Savior. You may place your offerings in the plate at the back of our chapel or use the electronic means indicated in our worship folder. We join now in praying our prayer of the church, and following that prayer, we'll also join together to speak our Lord's Prayer as printed for you. Let us bow our heads in prayer. We praise you, O Father, for the precious gift of your Son and for his glorious transfiguration on the holy mountain. Give us the firm resolve to listen to your Son, the eager readiness to believe his promises, and the joyful willingness to heed his commandments. By the sign of Moses and Elijah, show us that the blessed who are dead, who die in faith, for they shall know the power of Christ's resurrection and shall be changed from glory into glory. O God, our Father, let your Holy Spirit find a dwelling in our poor bodies and transform our weak, sinful lives into the radiance of goodness, purity, and righteousness. Transform our minds, our understanding, our judgments, yes, our whole persons, to reflect the mind of Christ. Take our sickness and pain, our disappointments and despair, our sorrows and mourning, our pride and anger, our selfishness and envy, our hate and fear. Take all of these, O Father, and transform them by the healing touch of Jesus into noble impulses, pure motives, kind thoughts, constructive deeds, high courage, and true faith. And so we pray to you, especially today, on behalf of two people. We pray first of all on behalf of Phineas Bader, the son of Pastor Noah and Missy Bader, as he goes back into the hospital for his second rounds of chemo. Lord, we are encouraged by the good news we heard after the first rounds, but we know that you are still the one in control. And we entrust Phineas to you. And especially we pray that you would give to him and his parents strength of faith and trust in you, knowing that you are working for the good of those who love you. We also pray that you would be with our member, Maura Seward, who has been moved to a rehabilitation center from the hospital. We ask that you would continue to let her body heal. We ask that you give her courage as her body continues to be racked with pain, and trust in you, and that your baptism of her reminds her always of the love that you have for her every day. Hear us, Lord, as we also now bring you our private petitions. Look on your church, O Lord, here and in every place, and grant that we and all who bear the name of Christ may daily offer up to you the acceptable sacrifices of repentance, thanksgiving, and loving obedience. Hear our prayer, and by your mercy grant our petitions for Christ's sake. Amen. We also join together to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We continue with the sacrament. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Praise to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In love, he has blessed us with every spiritual blessing. In the past, he spoke to us through the prophets. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son, who is the radiance of his glory. Now have come the salvation and the power and the kingdom of our God and the authority of his Christ. To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be praise and thanks and honor and glory forever and ever.
Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of your glory. You are my God, and I will exalt you. I will give you thanks, for you have become my salvation.
Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Then he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always. Forward as ushered by our usher.
Thank you. new blood of our Savior, which was poured out for you for the forgiveness of all your sins.
Thank you.
Please stand for our thanksgiving. People, O Lord, that the lips which have praised you here may glorify you in the world, that the eyes which have seen the coming of your Son may long for his coming again, and that all who have received in the body and blood the pledge of your forgiveness may be restored to live a new and holy life through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. Please be seated. Brothers and sisters in Christ, when we next gather for worship, it will be Ash Wednesday, the first day of Lent. On that day, we will begin our solemn journey to the Savior's cross. While the joy of faith remains undiminished throughout the year, our rejoicing during Lent is muted and quiet. For centuries, therefore, Christian churches have omitted their most jubilant songs during this season, including the word Alleluia, which means praise the Lord. Now for a time, we say farewell to Alleluia. We do this to prepare ourselves for the quieter days of Lent. The Alleluias will return on Easter dawn as we gather to shout our praise to the risen Lord. So let us now say farewell with our final hymn, Alleluia, Song of Triumph, number 977.
Thank you.
Good morning and welcome to all again. A special welcome to the guests who are with us today. Special welcome to those of you who also joined us online today. We hope that you will come and join us here in our chapel in the future. A couple of things to remind you of coming up this week. One is our Ash Wednesday service, 7 o'clock, here in the chapel on Wednesday evening. We will have our soup and sandwich supper at 6 o'clock downstairs, but we will come up for the special Ash Wednesday service, which will be a service with communion here in our chapel on Wednesday evening. And then after that, we will continue with Advent meditations downstairs with this after the soup and sandwich supper. So please do sign up if you're able to bring something. We don't have too many people signed up yet on the Wednesday evenings downstairs, so be sure to sign up for those and help out if you can for bringing the soup and sandwiches. Also, don't forget that the 25th is our next work day here at Zion. We have some more things around our campus that we'd like to accomplish in order to beautify our campus, especially in preparation for Easter. So if you're able to come on the 25th at 9 o'clock in the morning, we'll have a list of things that can be done here on our campus. And then don't forget that during the weeks of Lent, we don't have a Wednesday evening Bible class because we have the meditations on Wednesday evenings. And finally, after our fellowship time today, we continue with our study of the book of Revelation. So join us for that at 10:30. God be with you through the week.